And to the analysis of Shields and Brooks, that is Syndicated columnist Mark Shields and New York Times columnist David Brooks. Welcome, gentlemen.
Judy.
So let's start with the president's choice to be CIA director, John Brennan. Mark, he had the confirmation hearing yesterday. A lot of discussion about the use of unmanned drones. Did John Brennan help make the case for the administration, what the administration's doing?
Yeah, I mean, he did. I mean, just a note in fairness to John Brennan, David is time and again, and with some justification, pointed out that the nominees of the and appointees of the Obama administration have been overwhelmingly the sons and daughters of the Ivy League. And John Brennan is a graduate of Fordham University in New York, a Jesuit city school, and did graduate work at the University of Texas.
Glad to have that clarified.
Well, I just thought I wanted David to know.
The Jesuit League is well represented
as well. That's right. That's right. But I do think, Judy, that he was a far more formidable witness in his own behalf for his own nomination than was Chuck Hagel a week before. He was far more confident, far more informed, authoritative. This is the first time we've ever debated this subject. I mean, it's gone undebated. And I have to concede that much of the criticism, I think, from conservative press is absolutely valid. If this were George W. Bush and Dick Cheney, and we had increased by sixfold the number of unmanned attacks on other countries that are not combatant countries, that we're not at war with, there would have been far more hue and cry. And it's interesting that the president, the only criticism from the president seems to be among a few liberals, and the support seems to be from people like John Bolton and the neoconservative community. So it's a debate that I think we have to have, we should have, and it's been cloaked in secrecy, and secrecy is the sacrosanct secular religion of this city.
So this has really stirred it up?
Yeah, I think so. We're finally, because of the leaked memo and because of the testimony, we're having a debate about drones. And I guess if I want a drone policy, I want it run by a Franciscan, not a Jesuit. But, you know, he didn't really defend it, even though. He didn't really go out there and say, here's why we have to do it. You saw the chairman of the committee, Senator Dianne Feinstein, trying to drag an argument out of him. And he was very hesitant to go there because he wanted to adhere to secrecy. But because of the memo, we're having the discussion. And it's being led on the other side by the opponents, Ron Wyden and Jay Rockefeller, people like that. And so, you know, when I look at the evidence, one of the things you see is that people like Barack Obama, who were opposed more or less or skeptical of the policy, once they're actually in power, faced with the realities, you see them swing over. And so it's become a, if you think about if we're going to take on Al-Qaeda, I think the evidence is that it allows you to kill the leaders of Al-Qaeda with much fewer civilian casualties than a bombing campaign, than boots on the ground, than anything else. So it's an effective program for that. The two things I would say is the blowback from popular opinion is a real issue. The second thing to be said, and this Brennan gave no ground on, and I think it's a mistake, is who's reviewing? We've got really a group of people who all work together every day, sort of doing this process, sort of say to us, don't worry, we're doing a review process. I, as a supporter of the program, would feel much more comfortable if there was an external review process.
And now there's talk about secret courts, and then there's a reaction to that.
There is. There's the rule of law. I mean, Judy, presidents make mistakes. I mean, even great Democratic presidents. Franklin Roosevelt made a terrible mistake by interring 140,000 Japanese-American citizens. Abraham Lincoln suspended habeas corpus. Jerry Ford had to outlaw assassination, because when he became president, he found out there was a recommendation to assassinate Fidel Castro. I mean, so we do make mistakes, and the fact that the president's come over, yes, it's neat. We don't put Americans into combat situations. They're not combat situations. I mean, the fact that neighborhoods in Yemen are being hit by drones is known by the people in the neighborhoods in Yemen. That's no secret to them. It's been a secret to us, and I just think the failure to debate that has been a failure of us in the press, but it's a failure of political leadership as well.
And this accusation that the president's guilty of hypocrisy because of what he said during the campaign, what he said early in his presidency, is that a fair?
It's a fair criticism. I mean, for the president, I think the president has to make the case. I mean, because he's certainly, his position now is entirely different. David's right. He has a different responsibility now than he had then. And it is kind of neat, and you don't have the civilian casualties that you do when you're bombing from 20,000 feet. But at the same time, by the New America Foundation's estimate, 142 civilians have been killed in Yemen. I mean, we kill terrorists. How many do we create with these?
Right. Well, when you get that daily intelligence brief the way a president does, it changes your perspective. You don't have the luxury of doing the moral preening you do from the outside. And so he has a different view. But I do agree with Mark. It's just we should never trust concentrated power. That's not what the country's based on. It's based on checks and balances. And especially because it's so neat, because it seems so easy. You just order a strike and somebody in, I don't know, wherever, Tampa or somewhere is running the thing, or in Langley is running the thing. It's so easy. And so I do think it may slow down the acquisition of kill lists, but you do need a court review and maybe some former military intelligence people doing an efficacy review. But it would make us all feel better.
Another tough foreign policy question. We learned yesterday, Mark, from another congressional hearing that there's been a division in the administration, and this was what Ray Suarez's discussion was about tonight. We learned that Secretary Clinton, then Secretary of State, Secretary of Defense Panetta, the CIA director, all were in favor of the U.S. sending arms to the rebels in Syria. The president overruled it. Significance of this that we're finding it out now,
and just add the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff.
And the chairman of the Joint Chiefs
of Staff. So I mean, you had across the board, and these are not groups that walk in lockstep. State Department and CIA and Defense and the Joint Chiefs of Staff. The fact that they came up with him—I mean, first of all, the fact that it's out in the open. I mean, neither General Dempsey nor Secretary Panetta was particularly eager to talk about it. But it was—it did give us a look into this administration. The argument at the White House among the national security people was that it would strengthen groups. They felt the arms would inside of Syria, who were radical Islamists that would possibly be Sunni allies of other radicals elsewhere. The failure to do it, and the skeptics add that the president was running for re-election on the thesis that he was disentangling us from Iraq, Afghanistan, and further conflicts in that area, and that this would dilute that argument. And the irony is, of course, that the group that has taken the lead now against President Assad is, in fact, the Sunni al-Nusra.
It's significant that the president overruled all these folks. I mean, what does that tell us?
Well, when we were talking about Hillary Clinton's legacy, we were saying, foreign policy is run from the White House, and here's another bit of evidence that it is run from the White House. Now, the president has the perfect right to overrule.
Yes.
He is the commander-in-chief, and some of the best decisions, a man named Elliot Cohen wrote a book on this, some of the best presidential decisions have been overruling. So he has, within that perfect right, nonetheless, the concentration of power in the White House across a whole range of spheres is, I think, a little troubling. And second, it's very hard to believe that there wasn't any politics in this, domestic politics, I mean. Now, it could be arming the rebels was ineffective, but if you have this broad sweep of people saying we should arm the rebels, and then the White House says no, it's hard to believe, since it was so politically convenient not to arm, that it wasn't a mistake, and now the wrong rebels are in the ascendant.
Politics does have a role sometimes in
foreign policy. And the president did, in fact, overrule his advisors, including the vice president, including the Secretary of Defense Gates, on going after Osama bin Laden. And he listened to John Brennan. There are times when a president has to make that lonely decision, and that's where the buck does stop.
We'll bring it back home and talking about politics, pure politics. Inside the Republican Party, David, it looks like there are we've seen some evidence of this, but now it looks like it's more out in the open. Some of the traditional folks we've thought of as being traditional leaders of the Republican Party are openly challenging the Tea Party. Right. Is this a momentary difference of opinion, or is it some longer lasting?
I think it's the beginning of a longer lasting thing. There's been a lot of calls for Republicans to change, and we've seen that from everybody from Paul Ryan to Marco Rubio. Now we're beginning to see the donor class really begin to change. There's some question, are they trying to change just the candidates so they don't get Todd Akins, or are they trying to actually change some of the substance? And so far, it seems to be just the candidates. One of the interesting things, and I can't say I know the answer to this, is how much will the Tea Party fight back? There's been some effort that they're saying, oh, the establishment is taking over. But my own sense of things so far is that there's not the will to fight among the Tea Party, and that a lot of people in the Tea Party are, frankly, they're also Republicans. And a lot of, say, Rush Limbaugh, for example, who's not Tea Party, he's more an establishment Republican who wants the Republican Party to win. So I have a feeling that the establishment is going to have maybe an easier time of it than some may think.
What do you sense?
I think that William F. Buckley, the great conservative philosopher, had the best advice for Republicans here. He said, I always support the most conservative candidate who's electable. And that was his rule of support. And the Republicans have been nominating people who've been unelectable. I mean, I can think of five Senate seats, Delaware, Indiana, Nevada, Colorado, and Missouri, where they nominated candidates who were unelectable, and Democrats who were really difficult races, either to be elected or reelected, won in all cases, and the Democrats retained control of the Senate. 26% of the electorate, Judy, is either Asian, Hispanic, or African American. Republicans won 13% of that constituency in 2012. They've lost the voters between the ages of 18 and 30 by 22% on the average in the last three elections. I mean, they don't have a constituency. They've got to figure out how to get elected, how to nominate people who are going to win. They're not going to nominate people in New England to win who could win in Alabama or Mississippi.
That's why it can't just be about the candidates.
That's
it has
right.
to be deeper.
But yeah. as we keep being reminded, the Republicans, most of the Republicans who were reelected come from districts where they were comfortably reelected. And they do they see a reason to think differently, act differently when they're being supported by the folks who sent them to represent that district?
People don't change. So I read a study this week where they took a look at candidates. What happens when they get sent, when their district shifts and their district, say, becomes more moderate? Do the candidates themselves become more moderate? The answer is no. People don't change. So if you're looking for people atop the Republican Party to lead the change of changing the party, that is just not going to happen. It's going to be people out in the states. It's going to be people off in a new wing that's going to rise up and change the party from the outside.
Well, the problem, I agree with David, but the problem is they can move on immigration, you know, and that's there's a legislative response. They say, look, we are moving. But how do you do that with younger voters? I mean, you're a party that's looking for heretics rather than converts, which is what they've been. They've been an unhappy group. They're not welcoming. Eric Cantor, the House Majority Leader, made a speech this week about being more inclusive, with sort of a kinder, gentler Republican party, you know, for education and being and inclusive. I mean, but, you know, it's sort of a difference in tone. I think the Republican problems are serious. Ronald Reagan won young voters for Republicans, and they were the best group in 2012. 30 years later, that group that Reagan won was still, that's right. And that's the problem the Republicans have.
Well, we don't have a problem with the two of you. We love having you every single Friday night. Mark, David, thank you. And Mark and David keep up the talk on the doubleheader recorded in our newsroom. That will be posted at the top of the rundown later tonight.